We're going to have Councillor Barfuss give us a bit of prayer.
Our Father in Heaven, we're grateful for this opportunity we have to gather together this evening as councillors and administration and the press to discuss and the issues in front of our town and to let our citizens know what's going on. We're ask thee for thy wisdom. We'll be able to make good choices and decisions here that will benefit our community and that we'll be able to find ways to continue to move our community forward. And we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Councillor. All right, so today is February the 23rd and we have our regular council meeting. We're going to call this meeting to order and recognize the press, Tori McCarthy for Channel 32, and Kim Peavoy for Temple City South. Thank you for being here. We have a few adoptions to the agenda, and we could put them under other business. So we're going to have G. Summer employment, H, Rotary Community Foundation application, and I, extra community foundation application by the town.
And can we put J on there too, Mayor, as an addition? Chautauqua?
Sure.
In about 5 minutes. Thank you.
Okay. So we have an agenda amended. Councillor Barfuss?
I'll move to adopt the agenda as amended.
Thank you. All in favor? Thank you. All right. We don't have a delegation. We have minutes for the January 26th. 2016 public hearing. If you remember, we needed to bring a few corrections to it. So you have them. Is there anything there that Councillor
Had one more item that I recall from the meeting that I didn't see on the minutes here is that we also asked Mr. Dick to put a definition for community gardens, which he did. In the land use bylaw.
Since it is in the land use bylaw and that has been done, do you feel we need to have it?
I don't know. That was just, you know, in the minutes we itemized some of the things that
I understand what you're saying.
That was just one thing I recall asking him to do was the addition of the definition for community gardens. And I don't see it in the minutes.
Jeff, maybe you can help us with this one because the intent was to create some tighter parameters for this.
I know what the story is there. And this has been something Shem and I have been trying to work through. We don't normally put dialogue of the meeting in the minutes, especially in your council minutes. And there was no, because we didn't do it by motion, yes, there was some direction there. Actually, what you're talking about, you talked about in the council meeting, not in the public hearing. We watched the YouTube
video
just to make sure. And so we tried to put, because it was a public hearing, we put a little bit of the dialogue and some of the things. And then Ryan wanted us to wait till the council meeting to discuss some of the changes. And
yes, I remember that.
In fact, I started and you said, please wait.
So some of that dialogue was in the council meeting, and so we didn't put it in there because there wasn't a motion to follow up on it, although it did get done.
Okay.
So that's why in the public hearing minutes, you're right. Yeah. It is not there.
All right. I agree.
Okay.
So are you satisfied with
yes, that? Yes, I am.
All right. So in that sense, we need to have a motion.
I move to adopt the minutes of the public hearing of January 26, 2016.
Okay. Any more questions? Seeing none, all in favor? Thank you. Okay, this is adopted. Now we have the minutes of the regular meeting of the Town Council on February 9th, 2016. So,
a long time ago.
If there is any questions?
I will move their adoption, but there is one correction. There was a spelling mistake in Leonard Nichols. Yeah. Leonard Nichols' name is Leonard, so they didn't.
Right. I didn't see this one. I saw some others, but I didn't see this one. Yeah.
Well, yeah. What is the spelling?
L-E-O-N-A-R-D.
You need a D on the end.
Well, I think it's not
L-E-N-N-A-R-D. Sorry.
I think there's a L-E-O-N.
No, he's
L-E-N-N.
Oh, is it L-E-N-N?
We just missed the D.
Oh, just the D. So we'll add that.
So it's right. Leonard.
Okay.
Okay, so.
So anyway, with that correction, I move the adoption of those minutes.
Okay, all in favor? Thank you very much. All right, so we will now go to the bylaw and policy under 6. Bylaw 1647 is a land use bylaw. So, as you recall, we had said we would not adopt this bylaw until we had a final draft with all the typos removed, etc. I took the time to read it from cover to cover and send about 2.5 pages of little things that I found that could maybe still warrant some tweaking and fixing.
Jeff is draft,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff is on it, and I think when that is fixed, I think the document will be pretty well in its final stage. So Jeff, help me understand what you want us to do regarding this. Do you want us to do it now, knowing that you have those corrections to do?
So I reviewed what you sent me, and I had Nolan look it over, and it's my opinion that none of it is materially important to the document.
It's just tweaking
Again, I don't feel any time crunch to pass it. Like, we certainly don't have any obligation to do it right away.
Okay.
So it's really up to you. You can pass it, and then we'll do all that work on it, or we can wait.
Okay, here is my thing. I don't know how many of you read it from cover to cover. If we pass it, I don't want to be again the one reading it from cover to cover, so I feel that administration will do due diligence with what I sent them, and honestly, I think we're done.
If we remember Councillor Barfuss, on the February 9th meeting, he moved to direct administration to obtain a final, edited, and proofread draft of land use bylaw from ORS before bylaw 1647 be considered for third reading.
Right. So, but the draft that sent us was already quite corrected. There is just a few typos here and a few formatting issues.
Pieces, yeah.
Essentially formatting, there is a few things that are not placed at the right place, notes that are placed the wrong area.
We need to refer to Councillor Barfuss if he's happy with that.
So I read through it, I'm afraid. I'm afraid
did
I
you
did.
Send your notes?
I didn't. I had some that we could talk about if we wanted to, but they're probably already the ones that you caught. So, you know, I'm fine with passing this.
It doesn't change the intent of the bylaw. None of it does.
Question maybe administration could help us with. When you come back, if we pass this today and then you come back with, you know, the typos and formatting errors, is that going to be an amendment that we vote on?
Shouldn't be. No, I would suggest you pass it and then I report back when they're all done.
That they're all done.
That administration is satisfied that everything in the formatting and grammatical has been dealt with. That'd be how I would handle it.
And then we would get an updated copy just through our file.
Yeah.
Well, you will get.
We'll get you.
It's 300 pages. You probably can get a copy on your
that's what
cloud.
I mean. Yeah. I don't do paper.
Well, the land use bylaw has typically been posted on the town website. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah. So once it's passed, it's
so then it should be on the town website.
And of course, Councillor Peavoy, to be clear, that never precludes us from making amendments to it, right? If we see something after the fact that just isn't working.
So it's a living document.
Yeah, we amend
it, of course. Yeah.
So my response then to that answer, thank you. is, if we don't have to vote in any of those changes as an amendment, then this vote would be fine. But if we were just going to vote to amend that later, I would just say hold off.
That'd be my position as well.
So I'm fine with voting on this tonight, then.
Okay, all right. Would you like to, somebody give me a motion then?
I'll make a motion that we move third reading of bylaw 1647, land use bylaw.
Okay, all in favor of this? Okay. So we're done with that. Allowing policies. If you read your email, there was a change given to you regarding the fees and charges. The changes were to clarify what the fees were for, whether per diem, for a day, for an hour, for a program, for a session, what was that, were they for? And I think they speak clearly now.
So the one thing that I found in there that I would just like some clarification was on the Windy City Gym.
Yes.
It says monthly for $255. Is that correct?
Yeah, I believe so.
$255 a month?
That's
don't think so.
That's life number, or year.
Yeah, that's. I think that's a year.
Oh, okay.
I think that's a year.
Yeah.
Okay. So maybe ask that question personally myself.
That would be really, really high for any gym. I mean, you can get a membership in Calgary for $60-$70 a month.
Well, go. Well, but that's not for a member.
That's
not
a membership.
That's for the gym to rent the pool building. Yeah, okay. Sorry, that's not the membership.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, all right.
That's...
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Sorry about that. So that's they them pay...
Okay, that clarifies that then. Okay. I was looking at it like, are you kidding?
No.
It's $200 a year for a membership.
Well, that's what I was thinking, so I was just wasn't...
Yeah. Office, they are an independent organization from the town, so
yes, no, I realize that.
It's their fee to us.
All right, there we go.
Okay, yes. Makes sense?
Well, I'm fine.
Yeah. Okay, all right, why don't you give me that motion then? Since you're fine with that.
I'll move adoption of the fees and charges policy F-20-1.
Okay. All in favor?
As amended, you mean?
No, amendment.
As it's last drafted.
Okay, all in favor? Okay, thank you.
Mayor Cronen, can I ask a question?
I'm sorry, sure.
On our family passes at the swimming pool, we had a big conundrum down there where we had Aunt Jemima moved, living in Calgary, coming and going on somebody's family pass. How are we going to spell that out?
Yeah, that was an interesting question, and I think it begs the question, how do we do registration and make sure that we have the right person on in front of us?
So the family passes are bound by how many in the family now?
Yeah.
So that's one piece of it.
Yeah, parents.
Living in the same house.
So yes, we've defined that it's four dependent children in the home. Plus you pay an extra. But we're looking at some card scanning or some type of identification piece to use down there. There's some potentially some good options. It won't cost us a whole lot. So we're going to look at some kind of membership card scan system or something like that.
Good.
Thank you. All right. Let's move to item 7, other business. Seasonal wages increased. As you could see, Randy, the manager of Fox and Rec, Randy Russell, suggests that because of the changes in the minimum wages and for us to remain competitive, we need to increase our basic wage by 50 cents per hour. And I support totally that idea. I don't know about you, but I think it's very important for us to be able to be competitive. Otherwise, we lose our students to other towns and to Waterton. And we need those students.
How are our wages compared to other communities?
If you look at it, there is
yeah.
It's right there. Mm-hmm. You can see we're right in the mix. We're a little low in compared to some, and we equal to Lethbridge in some others. So it's Winamax. We're still good. All right?
Interesting to see all the councillors tilted sideways.
Yeah, I know.
Sorry about that one.
So if you accept that change, I need a motion to approve those changes.
I will move that we approve the seasonal wage increases as presented.
The 50 cents per hour.
Question, though.
Please go ahead.
How will this impact our budget?
We'll look at it real close, but I don't think it's going to be very negligible. And that's because and it all depends too. We budget an average because we don't know the age of all the kids we're going to get. And so we take an average. So we try and gauge when we do budget, how many do we think we have returning? So do we skew it up a little higher? How many do you think will be new when we skew it lower? So right now we've budgeted $14.42 an hour is the number we've used. So we've gone 16 weeks times 40 hours times $14.42. So we're still kind of right in the middle of the pay scale.
Okay.
We'll look at it one more time, but I still think we're going to be fine. If it's a change, it will be, I think, quite negligible. Yeah.
I mean, if you see there's four levels of on a scale. There's a level A, B, C, D, right?
Oh, there's five, actually. Five? We're for high school or university.
Okay,
students,
all right.
Yeah.
So you have one more category. So it's difficult really to tell, as Jeff said, what about if we have three at the higher range and 10 at the lower range, right? So the average would be more towards the lower range.
So on this scale here with the pool supervisors, that's Doug, then we don't have...
Yeah, we don't hire a seasonal pool supervisor, which is what that rate for the other towns would be.
Right, so that's why that's not there.
Yes, exactly.
That's right.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, so we are right in the...
One other question. Last year we had a problem manning our pool staff, lifeguards. Are we going to have a problem this year again, do you think?
I don't, and I'm sorry, Councillor Bengry, I didn't think we had a real staffing problem. We had a few that left us mid-season. And so we scrambled a bit to get a couple in, but I don't think we were, in fact, Doug's proposal you'll see down when we get to summer staffing, but you don't have it yet, is actually for one less lifeguard.
Oh, okay.
But if we don't have them leaving mid-season, that helps a lot. We had a couple of kids, mission calls and a few things like that, that August 15th we lost them.
Yeah.
Or August 1st we lost them. So yeah, we scrambled on a couple of occasions there, but I think by and large we were okay.
And we had the three sisters that we hired.
Yeah, we did. We had the new sisters.
Are we still in the same situation?
We'll see who applies.
We don't know yet.
Yeah, we'll see who applies.
Okay. All in favor?
Thank you.
All right. Good discussion. The Warrington Park Mutual Aid Agreement, you will see it's a similar agreement that we have with other towns. So feel that it is a good agreement and just mean that in case of trouble, we'll be there for them and vice versa.
I'd be happy to move that we adopt the Waterton Park Mutual Aid Agreement.
Okay. All in favor? Thank you. That's good.
Loving your pace tonight, by the way.
Yeah.
We're moving. We're moving. 70. I'm learning from Councillor Peavoy. 7C, CCW recommendation, the recycling conference. Okay, when we have the recycling, the CCW, Councillor Peavoy, that's for you, so I need your attention. For CCW, we had said, because Councillor Peavoy is on that board, that it might be interesting for him to go. The only thing is there's a lot of stuff that's not pertinent to us at all. So what I was wondering is the following. Do you want to go for the whole conference, or would you rather go for the day that is more applicable to our meeting, or to our kind of business we do in town with the recycling?
Yeah, I hadn't considered that in the past, not knowing how the thing was set up. Can you register for just one day? Do you register for all three? I had just calendared all three for the event. So I one thing I was planning to do was not eat at the function, because to me, those prices are, I could save some money eating elsewhere, so. You know, it's cheaper for me to just slip over, grab a burger or a sub rather than a $30 buffet for every meal.
Let's try to...
Plus, I don't eat buffets anymore.
Let's try to get Jeff to help us a little bit on that conference.
So my only thing on this is, at the end of the day, if my opinion only, is that Friday there's nothing pertinent to the community. Like, I struggle with that one a little. It's based on ag sector stuff, ag plastics and feeds and things like that.
It's the bags that you put all the bills through, right?
Yeah, and day one is tours only, so there isn't any sessions. And then, and you could toss a coin, in my opinion, on Thursday, too. It's got a couple good things, I think, but I don't know. It's just, I wanted to throw it out there. It is a recommendation from CCW that needs a motion. So I just wanted to throw it out there. I don't know how pertinent it is of a seminar, but you know, it's certainly an option. And I think your meals are included. It's just if you take a guest.
Oh, is that how that is?
I think you're okay. Now, I have never asked if we can just register for a portion, but I certainly could. But I haven't explored that.
Okay. Councillor Barfuss.
So my thoughts are is when I went through and looked at what's actually here, I think that there's pretty good value in the tours, actually.
Yeah,
and seeing what they've got those set up. I saw
that. And asking questions relevant to people who especially ship their garbage that direction.
Yes, yeah. And which then comes into the 9 o'clock meeting on the Thursday with the city of Lethbridge and their recycling program.
Lethbridge has a program, yeah.
Given that we ship so much to their solid waste disposal site, it's going to be really important that we're on side with whatever they're putting into place, because that's going to impact us significantly. So I see great value in you being there for the Wednesday, Thursday.
Okay.
Friday, I agree. It's all egg stuff. I don't see any.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So, Councillor Bengry?
I have a problem with the amount of money they're spending, $350 for registration, just to take tours. And I'm not wondering if we couldn't contact the city of Lethbridge and ask them to give us a presentation on their recycling as it is, one of their councillors, like Jeff Kaufman or something like that, come down and give us a presentation on the recycling or whatever. And I think we'd be just as adequate as $350 for, what, three tours and one meeting?
You know what you can do with Lethbridge is what we did last year or 2 years ago, I can't remember exactly, with the Waste Authority, a group of us went there with Lee, and we went directly to Lethbridge to see how they're doing their business over there. It was extremely interesting and enlightening, to tell you the truth. And so I don't know, I leave it up to you, Councillor, to look at it, because it's a conference that costs, it's not just a conference. Right. You have then a per diem, you have all that stuff, right? Yeah. You have the lodging, you have all that stuff that has to be added up. So what I'm hearing from Councillor Barfuss is that, yes, there is value. I'm hearing also that maybe we should kind of look at the overall package.
I think because Councillor Peavoy is new to this assignment, I think he needs to be there to take it in and learn what's going on and get himself up to speed on all this. It's one thing to attend the meetings cold turkey. He started off when Councillor Bert Barfuss had been there and done a great job with that. He's no longer there, and I think it's important that Councillor Barfuss get caught up to speed. And I think these tours and the Thursday, I think it's important for him to go.
Okay,
that's my feeling.
We're just bringing it here because we need a motion, right? Mm-hmm. So let's try to discuss the pros and cons and make sure that we're doing it.
And one thing I'm willing to do is look into ways to find out, especially those things that are most pertinent, ways to find, you know, access to that information and that, you know, training outside of this conference, such as, for me, one that was just really jumping out is the Thursday 11 a.m. session on the Waste Commission/authorities. Yeah. And so that
and
one, I mean,
in
I was...
In fact, that one is the one that kind of caught my eye.
Right.
I thought that one is an important one. And before you go, you need to have a good discussion with Jeff, because there is a few things there that we are realizing that an authority needs authority from somewhere.
Right.
And at this point, we...
That perhaps the authority is not...
At this point, we're not so sure. We're not so sure that that authority has any authority to do what they're doing. So, therefore, the need to look at the commission.
Yeah, we actually, that came up in our policy committee, which I can address when we go over some committee stuff. But yeah, that's exactly
That one is a very good one. So,
but as far as trying to find a way to maybe save some money, if I don't have to go on the Friday, like I say, that's just a half day.
When you add a couple of those things in together that are already in there, then I see the value in you going to that.
Okay. All right. So somebody needs to give me a motion.
Do we
do it for 2 days, for 3 days, or do we allow administration to find out if there is a rebate if we go only 2 days?
Well, and certainly, here's one example. If we can't, if it's not any cheaper to save that third day, it might be cheaper if I just don't go as far as per diem, et cetera. And
if you come back that night.
Right, exactly.
Right, okay, no, all right.
I'm planning to commute anyway, there's no hotel.
So let's approve it the way it is, and then we'll worry about the details.
Yeah, because once I have the packet, I'll know better, right?
Exactly.
I'll go right, okay. I'll just save that.
So, Councillor Barfuss, do you want to put that motion forward?
Sure, I'll move that we send Councillor Peavoy to the, what do they call it, the Recycling Spring Seminar in Lethbridge.
Okay.
And that the actual dates for him to be there to be determined between him and administration.
Okay, perfect. All in favor? Okay, thank you. Okay, let's move on.
Excuse me, one opposed. We do have one opposed.
No.
Sorry.
That's all right.
Yeah. Councillor, I didn't see you. You've got to make it.
You did ask for a opposition vote.
Okay, so.
Thank you.
It's passed anyways. All right. Let's go to 7D. Village of Stirling SEP grant support for the Mormon Trail. As you can see, this is an amazingly well-written grant application at the last minute was put together. And I think there's value in us trying to support it. Councillor Bengry, you are on the Mormon Trail. You should speak to that.
I think we need to support it 100%. I'm concerned whether we'll get anything because the ACP grant application is so oversubscribed this year, but it's worth a try, and I'd like to make a motion that we support the Stirling ACP grant.
Okay, for the Mormon Trail.
Yes.
Okay, all in favor? Thank you.
That's a question.
Go ahead.
I was reading through this. Does this commit the towns to more than we are already planning on spending or
yes.
not?
No,
that's what I was. That's what I was.
There's an implication.
Potentially, yes.
That's right. What I just.
Only if we get the grant. Only if we get. The
only if we get the grant and if we get the full amount of the grant.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
Otherwise, not.
Okay.
That's the way I interpreted it.
And we've committed 14 for the next 3 years in our budget.
Okay.
So we're okay. We commit $52,000 for 4 years at this point.
Yeah.
So if you look
at that, I think it's reflected within that application.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And if I may, Councillor Creed, I was in the meeting last night about this, and one of the questions I asked is, can we do like we've done in the past sometimes where you contribute maybe some capital assets or some labor or, you know,
in kind.
Yeah. And they said they were going to look into that. So, okay. I mean, if the answer comes back yes, we're golden. Because mm-hmm. volunteer hours.
I don't know if our administrator can answer that with grant applications or not.
Yeah.
Well, at this point, we just need to support them and hope even for the minimal amount of money, any money is good money.
Yep.
All right. So that the next one is the AAPG conference, which is a police conference. Personally, I'm interested in that conference. and I wouldn't mind going there. There is some interesting item there for small communities.
I saw the tour of the Tabor Sports Shooting Complex, and I thought we should all go.
You know something? I just say that I'm interested doesn't mean that somebody else cannot go. Okay? So it's time to let it be known. You know?
Well, you and Councillor Bengry, you're on the police commission. Yeah. Well,
no, it's contrary
to it. I think given the issues and things that we've been talking about regarding police and the potential maybe of looking at hiring somebody, I think there might be some real value in having somebody there. Mm-hmm.
Is our community a member of that?
No.
Which means we would have to pay the non-member fee, but I had Jeff kind of quiz them a little bit, and there are some interesting topics that will be discussed. And because of what came back, I thought, you know what? Maybe there is something there that's worth.
This is in Tabor, isn't it?
Yeah. And that's not that far away.
No.
So, Councillor Creed, are you interested to go? That's a question.
Yeah, possibly. Let me just check. This was on a Friday and a Saturday, right?
And Sunday morning.
But this Sunday would be a different story. Sunday's a wrap-up.
Sunday's an optional one. It's a bonus session.
The only thing, I don't have the right sheet in front of me here. I'm trying to think if there was a
23rd on here.
There was a closed session on Sunday morning, I think, Mayor, that I asked if they'd let you in as the mayor, and they said probably. They just didn't want general civilians. It was a closed session on the drug trade and drug issues within Southern Alberta.
That's right, which was something.
And so when I phoned, they said, well, if you send your mayor, we'll probably let her in, but we're not letting too many civilians in. And so I think that might have been Sunday morning.
Well, if it is, it is. There are some issues in this area that we cannot ignore. Yeah. And the more we know about it, the better we will be to deal with the situation in our town.
Saturday has a session on all the First Nation police chiefs will be there. There's a session with them. Mm-hmm. So there's a number of sessions that I never heard of this organization, but I've talked to the lady a couple of times on the phone about it. It could be an interesting meeting. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so
yeah, on the top it just says that, you know, so it's got the 22nd, 23rd, so
yeah,
I'm gonna do a quick search here.
Yeah, with pizza and
all right. So essentially, we need to have your blessings.
I'll move that we plan, you know, up to two members of this council to attend the AAPG based on administration's recommendations as we go get closer to that date.
Okay.
So do we need anything more in that motion?
No. I would suggest that we put the names to those two.
Put the names.
Kronen and
the mayor and Councillor Creed.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
And that way, she's in on the the confidential.
Yeah. All in favor? Thank you. All right, 7F. There are some financial indicators there, rather than indication, but it gives you an indication of where the town is going, that are extremely interesting. Maybe, Jeff, if you could walk us through them. You have received them in the past, if you had been on council before, you're familiar with them. If you're not, maybe Jeff, you could do a little bit of a job helping us interpret those.
So I'll start off with a couple of, not disclaimers, but caveats on these. The province does provide us with financial indicators. But what they've done this year is it's all online, and you can go on and you can compare yourselves against whoever you want. You can pull whatever numbers you want. So this is not all the reports, and it's certainly not compared against everybody. When they did our default report, they measured us against, was it 20 or 18 other communities? But it was just a bit of a spread from Westlock to, you know, to populations of pretty big to tiny. So what I did is I ran one that's compared against all towns in the province. Mm-hmm. So the major centers and the MDs, the special municipalities and the villages are not in this comparison.
Yeah.
Oddly enough, they won't let me compare against the MDs, but I'm going to talk to them about that because they blanked that out as an option for me. But I'd like to be able to do that. And just for my own maybe morbid interest, but so what you have is Cardston compared against every other who would be categorized a town in the whole province.
Okay.
So one thing I want to mention before we get into them is if council has a couple of indicators that you want to drill down on a little further, we can certainly do that. We can say we're curious about where we stand against everybody south of Calgary, or we're curious about Pincher Creek, Fort McLeod, Raymond, Clare's Home. You know, we want to know how we fare in certain indications, those communities. Very easy to do. They've done a really good job of laying all that out so you can choose that. But just so you know, what you're looking at now is Cardston versus everybody, and it's equalized assessment and equalized tax rates, meaning they apply a formula to try and level out, to try and make it a fair comparison as best they can. So it's not, when you look, for example, at the net municipal taxes, our tax rate is at 8%.
No.
Right, but our equalized tax rate is.
Now, so does that include any of the things that we do use or pay but other municipalities do not?
No.
Such as, well, no, that would just be pulling your mill rate. And you're going to see a chart that's going to show, you're going to see one that shows taxes per capita and another one that shows fees and charges per capita. And it will make sense, well, our electrical department is what plays into that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's the piece there. So no, they're not perfect. Trust me, there's a number of anomalies when you look at staffing. Well, how many have a golf course with full-time people and how many have an electrical department with full-time people? And there's a lot of anomalies.
All is not comparable.
And I can't drill down on that, for example. I can't say pull out golf course and electrical department employees from a certain town.
Okay.
It's not that sophisticated.
Okay.
So it's...
See what services and recreational facilities each town.
No, you can see, you can drill down on a number of reports to recreation, but it would be, for example, spending per capita. Actually, it's probably only spending per capita and maybe grants for those categories, but that's about it.
So you wouldn't know what they were spending it on or anything there.
No.
Okay.
Councillor Bengry.
Jeff, can you explain to me what non-residential assessment as percentage of total equalized assessment?
So what it's saying is if you take 100% of our assessment, what percentage of that is businesses, essentially?
Oh. It's businesses. Yeah.
And so you look at that as an indicator of the breakdown in your tax base. So what percentage is residential, what percentage is not? Now keep in mind, usually on these, and I can't say this with a surety, they pull out linear, they pull out any of those odd ones. It's strictly trying to look at residential and non-residential.
Shocks were below everything.
Yeah. All right. So, any other questions you need answered before we go through them?
Yeah. Just one.
Councillor Quinn, go ahead.
And I don't know. It may be a technicality, but they talk about median.
Yeah.
When I took statistics, they said there's mean, median, and mode.
Yeah.
And the median was halfway in between, and obviously. Mm-hmm. This isn't halfway in between the full range. I wonder if it's more of a mean, an average, by...
Right.
anyway, that was just kind of trying to figure out how they calculated that. They call it median, but according to my definition, it's not median because if the light blue is the total range, it's not halfway,
But would that range be? I wonder if there's a weighting in there, though.
Well, that's what I'm wondering. If
there must be.
My understanding was that the median
was the mathematical middle.
Is the mathematical?
That's what I'm wondering which I understand is the mean.
Terminology use.
So obviously, those on the higher end of the range weigh far less, right?
There's fewer on the high end of the range. It's like a bell curve.
Yeah.
Yes. It just means that depending where you are on.
Well, that's what I'm wondering. It's more of a mathematical way.
Yeah, it's totally mathematical, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Okay, should we go?
So I'll take 10 seconds per probably. Equalized tax rates, net municipal. So the only thing on here, we're in the mix. Obviously, one thing to notice is the trend, though. Mm-hmm. So you see over time the town's net municipal equalized tax rate is reduced by 0.6%, where by 1.3%, the average tax rate in other communities has increased. Mm-hmm. So you're bucking a trend as far as your net municipal tax rate.
That's
right.
That's a good thing.
The next one is just residential. So this takes in, it just breaks out between residential and non-residential is what it's doing. So again, there's just a trend to notice here. We're pretty much level. Mm-hmm. Tax rates, non-residential, there is a trend downward for Cardston, but we found ourselves finding the median where that we were much higher at one point in time by about 3%. This one's quite interesting, your equalized assessment per capita. So this is how much we have divided by how many people we have. So we operate a little bit lower than most communities, at least the median, and we're certainly on the lower end of the range.
Which tells us that we have found efficiencies somewhere.
Well, maybe I'm misunderstanding that, because what I would, my understanding here is that assessments per capita would mean that we're not assessing as high, right, which would mm-hmm. come back to the fact of just the
lower value.
Well, the higher citizens living in right. in some of our assisted living homes where they would have that assessment in there, mm-hmm. things like that. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we are not assessment per capita. There's a direct line between tax revenue per capita too, right? So we're on that lower yeah. end of that spectrum. So we're operating potentially per person. Again, your tax rate could affect this. If we were on the low end of this, but on the high end of the tax rate, then we were probably operating on the same revenue per person as other communities. But we happen to be on the low end of the range and median for both.
And bigger families would contribute mm-hmm. to this
that's right.
as well.
Definitely would, yeah. Because the assessment's split up, yeah, by the whole house.
Yes,
yeah. For sure.
Exactly.
Yeah, so that'll play in.
Councillor Bengry?
Jeff, as you look at these graphs, follow them. How do you feel? Are you comfortable with where Cardston is sitting?
Well, would I love to see that number double of assessment per capita? Sure, that would be great, because it means you have a lot of, essentially it may mean affluence, or it means you got a lot of small households, one of the two. Yeah, overall, I think what this shows is that when you get through all of these, Cardston has much lower than average debt per capita. It spends much less per capita on its operations than other communities, but we take in less per capita than other communities. So yeah. we tend to do okay.
Live within our means.
Yeah, we kind of live in a modest environment. That's simply what I find.
I would say that the true story is we're doing pretty good in comparison of other towns. Our debt ratio is extremely low, and we have revenue sufficient to pay for all expenses, and we have good services. So when you look at all that mix, we're doing pretty good, and we have become creative as to how to generate revenues.
These graphs need to be relayed to our public.
That's what I
said. In layman's terms, you know, so everybody can understand them and realize that the council is, you know, keeping our taxes and assessments down and utilizing the tax dollars to the benefit of the community.
It's interesting you said that. I said that to Jeff too. There is a story of success that needs to be told in simple terms, but we need to tell the story.
Yeah, we can figure out how to integrate these into maybe some reports or even release them systematically one or two at a time for some public consumption.
Yeah.
But really, Councillor Bengry, that's what I read. We operate in a fairly modest environment. Exactly. If you look at what our salaries per capita versus other communities, again, we operate a little bit less. We operate a little bit. There's other charts I might not have had in here, but the spending in different areas, we tend to be below many of them. But again, so are our revenues. So if I saw the other way, that our revenues were low and we were above the median and up in the high range on spending, I'd be very concerned.
Problem.
Yeah, that's a big problem.
Yeah.
But our financial statements reflect the same thing. Our financial statements tell the same story.
I think the word is conservative, and
we operate conservatively.
It's out there that for some reason certain people say it's so expensive to live in Cardston, you know, because of your assessments are higher and everything else. Well, these graphs reflect the totally opposite.
Statistically, their assessments aren't higher, and statistically, they pay less in taxes per assessment.
When you look at the equalized assessment, the story is that we are actually pretty low, well, not the lowest, but pretty low in comparison to many comparable towns. And people don't seem to understand that. They always say, well, you tax too much. But the statistics don't show that.
And these are not stuff that we put together.
No, that's a government.
You know, and that needs to be referred to.
Yeah. Okay.
So just real quick, non-residential assessment, we talked about as a percentage of total. Councillor Bengry asked that. So we, about 13.9% of our total assessment would be non-residential.
Yeah.
Percentage debt limit use. This is an interesting graph because I think it's somewhat misleading, and then it's also troubling, not for us, but the fact that someone's around 300% of their debt limit. First of all, why is municipal affairs allowing a municipality to be at 300% of their debt limit? First of all.
Mm-hmm. But just this past year, though. So.
Well, yeah, somebody's taken something on in a big way. But even you see so many of them above 100, which is a little spooky.
These are 2014, aren't they?
Well, this is a range from 09 to 14.
Yeah.
So the last number, so for example, with the town of Cardston, we're at 9.
So we're 1 year behind.
Yeah, because we don't submit our 2015 audited financial statements until May.
Exactly. Right.
Yeah, so they don't have them yet.
Which
so
means next year you might see a 2015 spike even higher.
Yeah.
That's what it means.
So these just came out, but the interesting thing is you look at the graph and it doesn't look like we're that much below the median, but look at the percentage.
Exactly.
Because the graph scale is from 0 to 400.
Right. Yeah.
So when you look at the percentage, we're at 9% of our debt limit and the median is 26.1.
Yeah.
So even though the graph doesn't show this great divide,
it's a pretty big
because the scale
divide.
Is so big. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty big divide.
So we're well below.
We're well below.
I'm suggesting what are these graphs going to look like in 2015?
Yes.
We're not
taking on debt.
It's municipal debt though, so it might not necessarily be any different.
Yeah.
The downturn won't have impacted municipal debt.
It could, but not necessarily.
If more municipalities have required the government to give them authority to spend more, which is what they do.
Well, if assessments drop considerably, municipalities borrow to make up the shortfall, that's obviously not sustainable for one thing, and you'll start to see that creep.
Yeah. And I really think, sooner or later we're going to see
even in Fort McMurray yet, which is probably the hardest hit town, we haven't seen assessments there drop yet. So their assessed values.
Because they are a year and a half behind time, right?
It's elastic, too.
So yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
It's a year and a half behind time.
The 2015 is not going to show that.
No,
assessments didn't drop in 2015.
No, because it's July of the year before, right?
It'll be elastic. So the next one is just percent of debt service. So it's simply our ability to pay our debt. Mm-hmm. So what percentage of that? And again, the graph looks like it's a minute spread, but it's because it's on a 600-point scale. But you know, we're actually the median at 20.6 and we're at 8.6. So again, we have plenty to cover our debts and pay them. A long-term municipal debt per capita, which I think is a very interesting graph. Again, we're about a third of the median, and I mean $4,000 per capita in debt on the scale. That's scary. But again, to be fair, while I don't consider this an anomaly, because if you look at the scale, it's a smooth curve.
Yeah.
But you'll see things in the town of Cardston where we will take out a $1.7 million letter of credit for the Creek Bank. Now we're going to get a grant to pay it, but if we happen to have that as a liability at the time of the year end, it's going to show as a debt. So you have to acknowledge anomalies. Mm-hmm. However, with a smooth curve at the top of that range, I don't think it's a major anomaly. Somebody out there is holding on to a lot of debt per capita. Mm-hmm.
It's very scary.
But we're sitting at 315. The 481 in 2011 was when we borrowed the $2 million to do the sewer outfall line.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's going to continue to whittle away.
We have about 7 years left.
Seven or 8 years on that, yeah.
7 years.
So that'll whittle down. Net municipal property taxes per capita. So this is showing what we take in per man, woman, and child within the community. So again, we operate in a more modest taxes per capita environment, and that could very well be that there's more people per household. That could be a big factor in that number. The next one is total grant. Again, we're pretty consistent. And it depends on the year. In 2010, we were well above the median because we got $1.3 million for the sewer outfall line.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So that skews your number, and it goes back and forth. Sales and user charges is where we see a big discrepancy between us and the median, and that's because we take in all those distribution charges that the other communities don't. So now we expend all of it, but we take it in as a user charge. Mm-hmm. So that's why that skews us above, well above the median. Major capitals per type. So this is one you can break down, because I just picked the one they give in the normal thing is just salaries, wages, and benefits to kind of show your administrative costs per capita. So we're right in there with the median. It's been up and down and around. And
what is interesting, it includes the electrical wages.
Yeah, so we have three more normally. In this year, we had three more full-time people than many municipalities would. Mm-hmm. And yet we still find ourselves below the median. So again, I think we operate that way fairly conservatively as well.
What was the spike in 2010?
So my guess on it was golf course, and we hired Vince.
Manager.
Oh. Okay.
And I think, so we had the three electricians, we were operating the golf course, we brought in a manager and paid him pretty good, and I think we had a bunch in that year. That's my guess when I look at it. It seems to be the right timing. So there's that. Assets to liabilities. This is a pretty common ratio for any business. And you can see that we're above, so we have more assets than
we're
we do.
Very solvent.
And the other thing that is important on this ratio, this is your short-term obligations and liquid assets.
Yeah, your current.
So we have enough on hand at the time of this chart
to
pay everything that would be owed, even with the loan on the alcohol. And then it just shows all the, this is every town in the province. That's who we compare it against.
Right. See, as we met with the auditors last year, the audit committee, our auditor extremely talked about our abilities to pay debt.
And that's a very important indicator.
You know, and that graph itself is extremely important.
So I guess to be clear, that would be the current year's portion of the long-term debt, too.
Yep.
To be clear on that, it's everything current plus the current year of the long-term debt. That's what that would mean. So anyway, that's the ones I printed off. If council, if you guys ever are wondering about a certain statistic, I can access the system, compare against any number of municipalities. So happy to do that. If someone quizzes you about something that, well, I from here and this and that, well, we can pull it up and at least see.
So the comparison.
Yep.
Do we have access to that site or not?
You don't, and you have to sign your life away to get access to it as well.
Okay.
So I can get whatever you want for you, but no, I'm the only one that can access it.
Okay.
It's fairly protected.
Yeah, it's called MileNet, and it's the new form that Municipal Affairs is trying to use to release all their information. So we do our audit stuff through there, we do grant stuff through there, we do emergency management stuff. So there's a number of things under it, and they have to vet you pretty thoroughly before you can go on. Not to say you couldn't, but I'm just saying, no, you can't write
it. So actually speaking, this is public information after we've received it.
Yeah, yes, and again, it's...
You can absolutely...
Anybody can come get your financial statement. So.
Anybody that you speak to can... you can
send them down.
You can show them what you have.
Yeah, no, it's based on our 2014 audited financial statement, which anyone can have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's no problem.
So on the whole, we are really in good shape financially, and that's another way to demonstrate that the trend of this past council and this council have allowed for this financial well-being to carry on. So that's good.
This to me shows full transparency in our financial situation.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, Jeff, for all that information.
I don't know how well it compares, but when I took a finance course, they said every business has a certain profile, and you know, like our instructor would say, he'd give us the financial statements, and then see if we could figure out what the business was. Mm-hmm. And he says, and the most successful businesses are the ones that are right on that average. And I'm just noticing our profile is, if it applies to towns, our profile pretty much follows very close to the averages. So I'd say we're a successful community.
As long as we're not looking at our gross margins.
Yeah, well, it's <that's> zero. Yeah, we're not. No.
Okay.
Usually growing.
We're non-profits.
All right.
But, you know, we are successful financially.
Yeah. Thank you. Well, I think we are.
We're in good shape.
Good. All right, so let's go to next item that has been added on, summer employment.
Oh.
And that is something that Jeff wants to talk about. You will get...
These are two additions. I'll talk a little bit while I hand this out.
Thank you.
Tara brought this to me because she wants to get advertising for the summer positions. Thank you. But I want some discussion on one part in particular. You will see that the positions from 2015 to 2016 are the same at 21 summer positions. However, the Historical Society requested a third summer student. And you can see we've dropped one senior pool lifeguard. It wasn't because of this. We were planning on doing it with the one less anyway. And so we were going to have one less summer student. And the Historical Society requested a third. To be very frank, I don't necessarily support that. We haven't historically had three seasonal workers for the Historical Society, and it's about $10,000 a student to do that. Now, one of the timing issues we had is we had already applied for all our STEP grants prior to the request. Now, it's all sort of relative. If we save money in parks, that's money that could be spent here. If we save money in pool, it could be spent there. I understand that too. We did apply for one museum interpreter under the STEP program. And then we applied for, what did we have? Two parks and two pool. Basically based on the ratio of the number of students we hire, when you look at how many are in each facility. So I wouldn't mind some feedback. We haven't told the Historical Society that we would be hiring the third. Tara put it in here, but I'd like some discussion about it before we go ahead with it. It's 92, 90, we budget 93. $300 roughly for 1442 an hour times 16 weeks times 40 hours a week. But there's also your payroll source deductions and all that. So I assume it'll be around $10,000 for the additional person. So that's the piece I'd like some feedback on.
Councillor Peavoy.
Yeah, two thoughts that I have on this. Number one, and again, this is more of a, as a concerned father, I'm assuming with the new slide up, we're going to have a lifeguard getting distracted by their duties over to the slide. So I'm shocked and a little surprised to see that we're coming down a lifeguard in the pool this year when we're adding a pool. But anyway, I just wanted to express that. I'm sure it makes sense to them. I'm sure they've considered that. I'd love to hear a reply.
Give me one second.
Yeah, you're fine.
But you're cutting down a senior pool lifeguard.
Oh, even worse.
You still got your,
I'm just kidding.
You still got your junior pool guards there.
Right, right. So, and I honestly don't understand how they schedule them or anything either. So, you know, granted,
yeah,
all so
that. That is a good question. It's a good question. There's no doubt. Okay, Jeff.
And then I'll have a second half. But go
okay,
ahead.
Let's
on
go with this one.
All I can go on is we asked Doug to submit his needs for it. He feels with the schedule they've got that if they have they're there all summer, that's the amount of lifeguards they need to cover the shifts. I don't know the intricacies of the scheduling very well, to be honest. So I'm just going on his recommendation from scheduling. So he inherited his staff last year because he didn't know. He hadn't been there a year, and he feels this year that that's the appropriate number. So, yeah, I don't know.
I only throw it out there thinking, you know, as the overseers of that budget, maybe we should mentally prepare for a request coming later. Right. Oh, I didn't realize we'd, you know, maybe we should have had that extra person there. So it's just a thought I'm throwing in. Yeah. My second thought, though, comes down to those museum interpreters. And I don't want to speak out of place, and perhaps Councillor Bengry might address this as well. But in yesterday's meeting, the Chautauqua Committee the Moreau Trail Committee was discussing how maybe we could borrow some of these seasonal museum workers from various communities who were hired for things. And just during the slow months, like especially in June, before the real tourism picks up, if we could borrow some man hours and get them on some of this Chautauqua stuff. And so we committed to, you know, going back and looking into the possibility of that. So if we do get that third museum interpreter and they're willing to share a little bit of their, you know, mental resources towards some of this, you know, Chautauqua preparation, that might be a really good use of that third person. So and maybe Councillor Bengry wants to speak to that.
I sort of disagreed with it myself because Mormon Trail and Chautauqua is two parts. And I think Chautauqua has to be self-supporting. And each community is responsible for their own Chautauqua presentation. And I can't see us sharing a student back and forth with another community. I never supported that last night in my thinking. That's the way I felt.
Anybody else want to add something to it? Councillor Barfuss?
I just happened to be going through some of the numbers earlier this morning, actually, on the museum and what's going through there. Last year, there was about 300 people that came through the museum. And given that we historically have been able to operate with two, I'm questioning the need for a third person to be there.
I think it's because one of their very seasoned docents has retired from the organization. I think that's a reason, probably.
So they're replacing a volunteer with a paid position. Is that what you're saying there?
I would imagine that's what it is.
Well, that.
Councillor Edmonds?
Part of the reason why the attendance was down at the museum last year was the way that they were operating. They were only open at certain times for tours. And when the tour was going on, they locked the doors. So nobody could get in for an hour. And that's why they had less people. Because if you didn't make it right on the hour and not knowing, people showed up. Like I saw five or six people just walking away. They looked at the door and said, well, we don't want to stick around for an hour before we can get in.
But what would be the historical number of people that would go through?
We're usually around 500 to 700.
Okay, that's interesting.
The high a few years back was 1,000.
Yeah, but I would say probably if you average
that, it would be
500 to 700. But I think the way they operated last year, it was something they wanted to try.
Yeah.
Because they found that a lot of people use it as a babysitting service, and they bring their kids and just leave them. And if you've only got one person, it's very hard to keep it under control. Mm-hmm. We had the same problem at the Cardston, because we had all those games for the kids to play, and people would bring their kids and say, I'll pick them up in an hour. And then it was up to the interpreters to spend their time keeping an eye on them.
It's unfortunate that people don't understand that.
Yeah. I guess what I would like to see is some kind of a reasoning behind it. I mean, not having any background with what's happening there, I would like to see some kind of an explanation from them why they're going a 50% growth in their staffing. And if, you know, if it's something like volunteer hours are down and so you've got to replace those with paid people, I mean, that's...
Yeah.
And part of it, and it's a legitimate concern, and it's just part of it, is someone being alone at the card home. Mm-hmm. There was some concern from people who work there of being by themselves down there. So I think that
safety,
that plays into it a little bit. When we ran it in the past, what we did is we just made sure that student generally had a cell phone all the time, so they could immediately phone the office or phone, because there isn't a phone in that building. So we did it that way. And I do think they may be losing some of the volunteers that have helped there in the past, but I know part of it had to do with that working alone at the card home. It was a concern for those that were there.
Yeah.
So that is a part of it.
Okay.
We have had problems with the card home. A few years back, we had a weirdo that wrote a love note.
Is that a technical term?
Yeah, wrote a weird letter to one of the staff saying what he wanted to do with her. Mm. And we reported it to the RCMP, and they looked after it. But by that time, the guy had left town. But he spent a lot of time just watching this individual at the card home.
Just throw a little light out there, because I'm very close to the situation.
I figured we might hear something.
Yeah. With they're having to go through the inventory there, which is very costly. There's a lot of money there, and they haven't had sufficient insurance to cover losses. And there is a concern there, especially when they take the tours. When there's not that other person there, they have no control over who comes in there, because especially if the young kids are not, they don't have an adult there, or they're not supervised. And even when they are supervised, my wife's had a lot of school groups all winter long. They've been open. which in the past they haven't. Every Tuesday, they're open, and for our school groups. And there's been a lot of them coming through there this year. It's very difficult. The teachers don't see all their kids. When you bring in a group of 30 kids, it's hard for two sets of eyes to watch what they're going in. They're touching, and those things can't be touched. The displays are, they're not, yeah, they're just not interactive. And so right now I know my wife is going through inventorizing everything and coming up with insurance and all that. It's a difficult thing, and that's why the extra person is really needed. It's
all right.
For crowds.
Okay, so here's a question for Jeff. Jeff, if we were, if this council were to support the extra position, where does the money come from?
The one less lifeguard? I mean, that's what it would be. Mm-hmm.
Essentially, yeah. It's one for the other, right?
No.
It's a give and take. Yeah. Kind of.
The other unknown is a step grant. So we've applied, but what we'll get, I have no idea. So I believe step grant is 50% of minimum wage, I think. Mm-hmm. So there may be some funds to help offset that, but we just don't know yet. We won't know, because one of the intents of step grant is that you're going to hire them anyway. Like, they don't like you to base your hiring on whether or not you're getting the grant, so generally they don't tell you till
right.
a little bit later. So you've made your hires, and then it's a reward for hiring, but they don't want you to base your hiring on it. The Canada Summer Jobs Grant, which we applied for as well, but we historically don't get much from them, is the same way. They won't tell you until you've kind of made your hiring decisions, and I get that. I do, that makes sense. So, you know, historically, and Councillor Edmonds can maybe speak to this a little bit better, but they've had volunteers to kind of pair up or spell off. I just don't know where that volunteer inventory sits anymore. Okay. I'm not close enough to it to know.
Now, here's a question for whoever is going to be at the meeting. I understand that they're trying to get members to kind of become paying members of the society. Do we have any idea what the number?
They have 39 paid members now.
They have 39.
Is what Diane told you?
Okay.
She told me 30.
Okay.
I think it's 39.
So is it possible that in those 39, which is more than what they ever have had,
that's right,
that there is an extra volunteer or person that would love to volunteer to be that third person?
I know my wife has talked to me about that. She talked to Councillor Bengry about that. A lot of them are elderly people that just can't do that. She's trying to get up. I know she's commented this morning that she's going to have to volunteer a lot of hours this year at the museum because she doesn't have the volunteers that she's been trying to get. She hasn't been able to get the commitments. It's just not an easy situation. And so I know my wife spent an inordinate amount of time there last summer, and she still does.
So that's what I wondered. I wondered if then in that pool
there was
some potential volunteers that could give them the extra hours.
The problem is a lot of your volunteers just want to do specific things.
Yes.
They don't want to come and spend every Wednesday at the museum. They just want to say, well, I'll do oral histories.
Okay. All right. So give me a little bit of a sense before we go on voting. How we feel. The lifeguard is one down, and that's because
Mayor, that senior guard position, I wonder if I'm with Councillor Peavoy. I sit here and mull this around. We're going to have the added slides, and I wonder if Doug has really figured supervision is going to be required on that slide. You know, climbing the ladder and standing on the platform and issuing and letting them go and stuff like that. And I think you should ask him to review that again.
I just texted him again to say, I know I've asked already, but I need to know again. I mean, we could look at this, leaving that in for now. It's in the budget for now with the five.
Yeah.
So we could, you as a council, if you chose, could have that as five. And then if we change that mill rate time, we can tweak it then.
Okay, so let me understand. We could have five, but then that bring the total to 22?
That's right, if the third Historical Society stays in, yes.
Just out of curiosity on the lifeguard, I mean, though you have that total number that you hire, they're not all on at the same time, so I wonder if he's looking at just giving more hours to some of them than
and that, I used lifeguard, and I know that there's a set number of guards that are required for
X number of states. They're required by unprovincial base, yeah.
And I would assume that Doug knows what those numbers are, and these fit well within those numbers. So my assumption would be that he's just changed the shift schedules and stuff around so that he's giving, because I know last year there were guards that weren't working 8-hour shifts.
Councillor Barfuss, I used to run this pool down here when it was a lap pool. Mm-hmm. Okay. And the requirements down there was you had two guards, one for the deep end, one for the shallow end. Mm-hmm. Now our pool structure has totally changed, mm-hmm. where we have a lap pool, we have a river run, we have the kiddies pool, and now we have a water slide.
And that's
so
all
the requirements for guards might have increased.
I suspect that the requirements for the guards that are on deck probably has. So just with whatever's in the requirement there for the provincial.
I'm not wondering if we shouldn't leave that position open right now.
I kind of lean towards letting our managers make those decisions. They're the ones that are, he knows what he has to have on staff there. I mean, he knows what those regulations are.
I think as a happy compromise, if we can find someone interested in history that's also a good swimmer,
pull over just in case.
I kind of like it.
Does the slide go directly into the pool, or does it go into the splash area?
It's a splash.
So you wouldn't really have to watch it that closely.
Honestly, no, you don't have to watch it closely. I mean, I've been to lots of pools.
But you have to make sure that there's no mutiny on the top.
Yeah, it's more on the top than drowning.
Yeah, it's a mutiny if you don't want.
Down the bottom, just in case they fall out.
Right.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm of the opinion that we should allow that manager to come back to us and really be able to say, absolutely, I looked into it, and I'm confident that the way I've scheduled things will work for us all. And I think under those terms, maybe we can.
I'm curious if we pass this in principle, or however we're planning to pass it, and then let's say by our next meeting it gets an amendment, that would be pretty simple to just say, we agree with a quick amendment based on new information.
Essentially, so, what I would like to know is a little bit of a quick round of the table for the museum interpreter. Councillor Bengry, I understand you're supporting that. Councillor Peavoy?
Yeah, I would like to maybe just ask if they'd be willing, for those people who are maybe sitting there waiting for someone to come in or whatever, if they could dedicate some mental hours to Chautauqua, even just here locally. Maybe not to the Sterling Chautauqua, but maybe ours.
All right. And so, Councillor Edmonds, I understand you would be supporting that position. Mm-hmm. And Councillor Barfuss?
Torn on it. I don't know the answer to that question.
Councillor
Curry? Yeah, if it's proven that there's a need, I'm supportive of having a position if there's a real need for it.
Councillor Edmonds?
If it's done right, the people don't sit around waiting.
That's right.
We do not know exactly how much that collection is worth. It's never been assessed. We're only now finding out what we have and what we don't have.
In other words, what you're trying to tell me is there's a lot of work that needs to be done and that can only be done with an extra personnel on deck.
Yeah.
That's truly what you're telling me. Well, can't argue with that position. So, I need a motion.
I will move to approve the administration's recommendations on summer employment for 2016.
In principle?
Well, sounds like you might be exactly how it sits.
Right, yeah.
Okay, all right. So all in favor? Okay, Councillor Barfuss, against? Okay, it's fine. Thank you.
And just to be clear, it's not that I'm opposed to it. I just don't feel like I got enough information to make
I understand. It's a little bit of a difficult position, but right now it's the same budget. Okay, let's go under H. Rotary Community Foundation.
Another sheet.
Lucky.
It's two-sided.
Okay, thank you.
I'll talk while I hand out here again. Skylar Levitt from the Rotary Club called me this morning and said he would like to apply for the Community Foundation grant to support the playground at the Lions Park that they, by the way, got the CFEP grant for.
Yes, really good size grant.
How much?
They got $100,000. Yeah. So in our budget, we've told them we would commit $50,000 in cash, and then we'll probably also help with a lot of the in-kind and machine hours and stuff too. But he was going to apply for this, and I said, the thing is, Skylar, you need to make sure that's a priority of council, because community foundation grants have to be applied for by the town. The Rotary Club can't apply for them, so they have to funnel them through the town, because we're the registered nonprofit. School can do them as well, so school and the town can apply for them. So I said, we just need to make sure that council endorses this application, because you know, it's got to come under the town's name.
But it is time sensitive, from what I understand.
And I hadn't been watching this one, but the deadline, they do two a year. This first deadline's on Friday. So the Rotarians will write the grant. Skylar will do all that. It's fine. He's just going to need a motion to support this. The only caveat I would throw out, I phoned the foundation today to say, to ask them if we could make multiple applications. And the answer was, they understand that the service clubs use the town to apply through. So as long as it's clear that the Rotary Club is applying through the town for this, and then the town is for something else, so it's not the same entity for the same project, applying multiple times.
Okay.
They obviously don't support that. Which is the next piece on the agenda. I just wanted to throw out a couple of things that potentially we would submit an application for as well.
Do you want me
to just segue into that, and then we'll come back to this?
Yeah. And then we'll give you the two motions.
Yeah, both of them at the same time.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously we have the pool building. We did get $15,000 from the Community Foundation for the water slide. We received that grant. And so we have the pool building this year, which could obviously benefit from that. The other things I noted, now remember the Community Foundation looks at basic and special needs, community vitality, and healthy living. So we can make the pool building fit quite well, as far as we're putting in handicap accessible washrooms, family change rooms, things like that. So if we even looked at those components, that would go over very well. But the other thing we've used this grant on before that we have in our operational budget again this year is $10,000 for the Tanner Center. They need their signs replaced, and they need some paint, and need a little work done. So we've operationally budgeted $10,000. And I know that the Tanner Center, we've been successful in that application before with the Community Foundation. So that's another one I looked at. And also, potentially, the card home needs some repairs as well. I think at the end of the day, the Tanner Center is a stronger application just because it's used so much more. Not to say we wouldn't do the card home, we budgeted to make those repairs. I'm just looking to offset costs at this point. And I think the Tanner Center is a stronger application, or the pool building. Those are the two I think probably fit their mandate and would be the best received within the town. So I throw those out for some consideration, or if you have other thoughts of things we can look at, by all means.
So just to clarify my mind here, if we support the grant for the Rotary, it doesn't impact our ability to send in a grant for the others, or it
maybe
does? Maybe.
I don't. It is my opinion, and only my opinion, because I've talked with the foundation a number of times over the years. They like to spread out their disbursements. They like to see Cardston get a little, and McGrath get a little in the village and the county, and they like to spread it out. So if we were to put in two, and they like to cap them about $15,000. These are not $100,000 donors.
Yeah.
These are lots of little grants. That's what they like. 5 to 15 seems to be kind of their wheelhouse. I think if we were to submit two $15,000 grants, we probably might only get one. If we were to submit 10 for the Rotary and 10 for the Tanner Center and 8 for the Tanner Center and keep it in that reasonable range where the total is around 15, I think that would work okay, but I try and keep it under 20,000 between the two, personally.
Okay, all right, so the Rotary needs how much?
Well, all they can get their hands on.
No, no, but essentially...
He said between 10 and 20 is what's got.
So if we were to say 10, and to be a little selfish and keep a little bit of a blanket...
Yeah, if I were to go to say there's competing priority scale, so we want you to keep this grant around the $10,000 range, I think you totally understand that.
Okay, well, maybe that's what we ought to do.
Well, and one thing I want to remind our council of is that, you know, technically it's not us versus them. This is our citizens.
No, it's,
and our citizens.
It's our play.
So this is, you know, we're putting Tanner Center above our children's tot lot type thing, and you know, maybe I'm not saying we do, but maybe what we do want is a lot of support going towards that, and let's get that thing built, you know. So I'm just saying it's dollars to Cardston either way. So, you know, it's not like it's us versus them, and no, we don't want the Rotary's getting it. It's all Cardston versus Cardston here.
Yeah, no, I totally understand what I was trying to say, saying selfish. I was trying to say, can we share the wealth around? That's what I was trying to say. Can we give some to the seniors that need a building kept in good shape? And can we also help the Rotary carry on with their fundraising?
Have the seniors got the capability of raising funds for themselves?
No.
Well, they have
maybe they never have the
reason why I ask that is because we have an historical site down on Main Street, and if we don't keep the upkeep and the maintenance on that building, it's going to deteriorate to the point where you can't repair it.
We have approved budget
money. But there's money in the budget for that.
There's
right?
money for that.
It's not at risk.
Oh, okay.
You've approved it, it's done.
No, no. Okay. What we're trying to do is get the cream on a cake.
To get some more money.
One thing to keep in mind with the Tanner is the Tanner Center, the seniors totally take care of all the renos and upkeep and everything that needs done in that building.
Inside the
but
building.
But out of the building and the grounds
it's
is the town's responsibility.
Okay.
So that's the split there.
Jeff, on this community foundation grant, if you apply, say, for 10 and 10, do they either go yes or no, or do they sometimes give you a partial? Like, if you ask for 10, would they maybe say, well, we'll give you 5 or 8 or something? Does that happen?
I don't know. I know CFEP does that, where we'll apply for 125 and get 50 or 100 because they look at their subscription. I don't know that for sure. I can ask, though. Jason Common is actually the member of the board for the Community Foundation for this area.
Mm-hmm.
So I could definitely ask.
Mm-hmm. I guess I want to understand a little bit more about what the town's contributions have already been to this project.
To the playground?
Yes.
At this point, nothing. You have approved in your capital budget $50,000 for 2016.
Right. So I guess what I'm saying here, if for some reason we prioritized to make sure that we got some money, then we've already earmarked $50,000 for them, so they shouldn't be too upset if we for some reason decide that the Tanner is a priority at this time. That's just my thoughts. You know, I know the seniors don't ask a lot, and if there's need there for that building, I don't want to cut them short on what they need to do either.
Now again, to be clear, the money for the Tanner's in the budget.
Already.
You've approved that.
We approved that already?
I'm looking at things that are already in the budget and identified as priority.
Yeah, that's just why I wanted to
understand. As a way to offset costs.
Thank you.
Yes.
That's right.
That changes my thought.
So my question then would be perhaps to administration. Is it possible for us to draft a motion where we just delegate to administration to find the best way to save tax dollars? So the most effective way to do that, chop it up.
An overarching motion.
Direct administration.
Do whatever you want to do.
To choose.
Essentially, what we want to be successful, maybe on one front, preferably on two fronts.
Right.
So that one application benefit the town directly, therefore the taxpayers, and the other one benefits an association that's always helping the town.
So you could prioritize these grants. Like I could submit to the foundation that this is the priority of grants in the case of being oversubscribed.
Mm-hmm. So, in other words...
I like that idea of prioritizing. Because our seniors are always giving back to the community. And so I think we need to look after the seniors, you know, so that is a...
But this isn't the case of that they're not going to be looked after. We've already budgeted the money to do the work.
Oh, yeah.
So it's not a case of if we don't apply for a grant for the Tanner Center that it's not getting done. We've already budgeted those funds. This is just to offset it if we need, this gives us extra $10,000 or whatever that number is.
Any money that you get allows you not to have to raise that money through taxes. Essentially, that's what the story is. So if it comes to us for a town project, we don't need the tax money to do that project.
So
if it goes to the Rotary, it gives them more money to do a project that will benefit the town.
Yeah. Now, I would suggest the Rotary right now is short money.
Mm-hmm. And they are short.
They're not trying to minimize out-of-pocket costs here. They can only spend what they've raised.
Right. So
they need about another $50,000 to finish their project.
Yeah.
In this letter here, it said that they're asking to request 10 to 20,000. So if we ask for 10 for them and 10 for the Tanner, I think we're supporting both.
And then if that was the case, assuming we got both of those, which who knows, that would give us the ability, if we needed to be able to donate from our budget. Because we've got the 10,000 we've received from the Tanner Center, right. Then we can take our budget that was budgeted for Tanner Center and
hire museum staff.
Hire museum staff.
All right.
Really shift the money around.
This person swim.
All right. So I think it's time for decision. If I understand, maybe $2,000, $10,000,
yeah.
One for the town, one for the Rotary.
Support,
yeah. Do we feel comfortable with that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so maybe I need a motion to have this clearly explained.
Okay, I move that we
support
the Rotary Club in their application for this grant for the Community Foundation Leverage Grant. In the amount of $10,000.
And can you give me another motion?
And I further move that we, second motion, that we apply for a Community Foundation leverage grant for the amount of $10,000 towards the repairs for the Tanner Center on the outside.
Point of order, Mayor.
So, Ray, you need two motions.
I don't believe we can put a second motion on the table. On the first table.
Okay.
Jeff.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah, I'll be right back. You guys go ahead.
Okay, you need two motions.
Okay.
Okay.
So, the second portion, they go with the first for now. Okay. So, in with that, then Jeff talked about a priority.
Yeah.
We need to inside of the motions, put down where a priority is on those, maybe,
or just allow Jeff the leeway to add that at his discretion.
Our third motion,
if he feels like that's necessary from the town's perspective.
That's a friendly amendment.
I think the friendly amendment.
That's where I was going.
I think a friendly amendment that you could make yourself to put that grant is a priority.
Okay, so then if you'd accept the friendly amendment to make
that. Sorry, are we saying this grant's the priority?
The Rotary one.
The Rotary one is the priority.
Yeah.
Are we sure that's what Jeff said?
Well, Jeff didn't.
He didn't say. So, I mean,
what he said is that they are still short $50,000 or so,
right,
yeah, in their completion of their,
yeah. So what I'm looking at is we've got the other two budgeted for already.
That's right. That's right. Why this is probably a priority.
That's why I would say this would be the priority.
This over getting nothing, certainly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, but it's 10,000, so we're going to have another motion.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. So,
do you want to read that, Sam?
the motion needs to have embedded that grant would be a priority grant.
So
application. Okay.
You want to read it?
I've been recording it, so I can put it in there later.
Excellent.
So in other words, it said that the town supports the Community Foundation application for Rotary
Club.
$10,000. as a priority application.
As a priority application, right.
Okay, so second.
We need to vote on this first.
Okay, all in favor?
Well, if I may, just before the vote, I'll adjust back. So in the motion, they added that the Rotary grant application would be the priority that you would ask for. Okay.
Okay, so all in favor? Thank you. All right, well, that was a little bit of discussion. Okay, so we need a second motion to support a second community foundation application from the town.
I also move that we support another application from the community
foundation
in the amount of $10,000. For the benefit of the Tanner Senior Center.
Okay. Would that work, Jeff?
Yeah, sounds good.
Okay. All in favor? Thank you. Wow, put those to bed. Okay, so now the Chautauqua. Councillor Bengry, if you don't mind. You told me
I was overwhelmed with information yesterday afternoon at our Mormon Trail Committee meeting. Number one, we are getting the play 4 nights.
The
major play
in
is in this town for 4 nights, starting Wednesday night. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and then the big wrap-up show on Saturday. The venue will happen in the other communities, but it'll happen during the day. We have an evening show every night.
Okay.
And if I may, the purpose of that just being that, you know, if we can only seat 400 to 500 and we get 2,000 people that want to see the show, the only way to accomplish that is to have more shows.
Yes, okay, absolutely.
Either that or we got to find a big tent that seats 2,000 viewers.
From a logistic point of view, where do you intend to hold that?
We'd like to have the show right here in the Civic Center, in our gymnasium. It holds up to 700 people if we use the balconies. But we feel we would see it for 400 people and sell pre-sale tickets up to 400 people.
Can you give me the dates one more time? August the what?
August 10th, 11th, 12th, and 13th.
Okay. So, from an administration point of view, do we have anything going on in the building in August?
No, it's been booked shut, hasn't it, for the Chautauqua?
I think we're okay then.
So, we're okay?
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay, all right.
I'd also ask council for a motion to waive the costs of the building that we're going to use. I'd like to use the skating rink. The ICE Center, and the Civic Center, and the...
Where's that paper? Basically everything. Everything the town can offer, we need that.
Yeah, we need Chautauqua. Those facilities for the Chautauqua on Saturday.
Every park.
Yeah.
Tell the school we need it.
Yeah, but hold on a second. All that is good, but that week is Heritage Week, and there is quite a bit of things.
No, Heritage Week is before.
Perfect. You had me a little worried there for a second. You're right, August the 8th is when we...
The only thing that we have to worry about on the Thursday is the farmer's market is down at the ICE Center,
right.
And we won't need the ICE Center until the Saturday.
So has that been booked already?
The farmer's market?
The ICE Center?
No. We got it. This is what's happening tonight.
We're approving it, and then it's all getting worked.
Okay.
When's the family run?
First part of July sometime,
yes,
I'm not sure.
That's not done. Okay, maybe. All right, so.
I thought it was later. I thought it was in August.
No.
No. They changed it.
You changed it. I'm not sure.
It's the same week as Heritage Week.
Pardon me?
Okay. They moved it to Heritage Week.
That's in August.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the week before.
The week before, the first week in August.
August 8th.
Yeah. The weekend before this.
All right. So, essentially, Councillor, do you want to put a motion forward requesting the waiving of the fees for rental of facility
owned by the town?
Should be part of.
Of the facility used by the Chautauqua?
Please. That's exactly what I want.
No, that's your motion. I can't make that motion, Councillor.
Then I'll make a motion that this council waive the fees
for the
rental.
Rental of the town
facilities. Required for the shutter clock?
Yeah, required for the talk clock.
2016?
Yep.
August 10th, 11th, 12th, and 13th?
Yes.
Just for precision.
Friendly amendment. And also, it's very likely that the Chautauqua Theater Group is going to be needing space for rehearsal and such, and they're not getting a big budget for this. In fact, it was even talked about free ticket sales, because we're trying to keep it affordable for people.
It says community facility, which includes this one.
Right, but this would be prior to, this could be a month or two even.
So maybe not put the dates on it?
So like, they might need room for this room on a Tuesday for a rehearsal up to 2 months prior.
Okay, so for, maybe we can put for the shutter clock and pre-shutter clock.
Pre-show rehearsals, yeah.
Which we don't know when.
To my mind, basically all we're saying is whatever facilities the that we waive the rental fees for, okay, for whatever they need it for.
It's fair enough. We understand the needs of that organization to
accommodate them wherever we need.
To do something. I mean, it's in our best interest.
Side note, this is petty, but we are in a direct competition with Sterling. Their whole community is just beating us in every way, but we think we can overtake them and succeed.
You know what? Let's be all together on this one. Let's be brotherly.
That's it. Well, okay. The thing that we want to make sure is we have volunteers in place, programs in place for that Saturday. This is snowballing. And the advertisement is spectacular. Good. for the tourist information pages and things like that.
Okay.
Jeff has seen those advertisements. They're beautiful.
Can I, later on in the report, I will give you a venue where you can do some free advertising. I'm going to give you that venue.
But so, you got a motion on the floor.
Yeah. So this way. All in favor? Thank you.
Well,
I'm
thank you.
Really excited. Do you have a drink?
I need a break.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay. Please give me a motion and we'll have a break.
I move to have a 5 minute break tops.
All in favor? Thank you.
So yeah, all we need to do with our meeting is get our the speakers on the water. Yeah,
sure.
Yeah. Yes. Absolutely. Yeah, so we're good.
We got a 3 to 1. That's on the first page.
Yeah,